Welcome here in our fourth webinar, An Insight to Mindfulness, here in Moodle Academy. Today with us, we have Usha Raman. Usha is a certified trainer, behavior consultant, and a master of life coach. She facilitates workshops in personal development, specifically in the areas of mindfulness and emotional intelligence. Her love for trading has enabled her to train hundreds of people globally, and today is with us. When not in training, she is an advocate for volunteerism and has organized self-empowerment programs in Asia Pacific for over 20 years. Currently, she is a lead volunteer administrator for two non-for-profit catering to refugees and other vulnerable communities. In 2019, she received the award Iconic Woman Creating a Better Future at the world-renowned conference Women Economic Forum. Having positively shifted her life and career through embracing mindfulness and emotional intelligence, she can now made it her mission to share mindfulness and emotional intelligence strategies so that people and organizations can thrive no matter the circumstances. Usha, welcome. Thank you so much for being here and initiate mindfulness in Moodle Academy. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Anna. I'm really excited to be here to share this topic, which I'm very passionate about. So, and it's, you know, so welcome to everyone, and thank you for coming online. So this webinar today, this insight into mindfulness, is a more of an introductory session. And, you know, I often get asked, this term mindfulness gets thrown around so much, you know, and everywhere these days there is a mindfulness course going on. Like, what do you think about that, Usha? Is it just a buzzword or something? But I, for one, am very grateful that the term mindfulness is getting so much airtime, because I think it deserves it. And now, because of that, we've got so many researchers and scientists on board studying the benefits of mindfulness and how it can help us in so many ways. And very honored to have two of those researchers here today as well, Anna being one of them, and Asteria as well. So yeah, it's attracting a lot of good attention, so that we can then have more evidence-based proof of what an amazing well-being technique this is that we can all adopt. And we can all adopt it quite easily, which is the best thing about mindfulness. You know, it's not one of those quick fixes, but it's one of those with all the time with me fixes, so to speak. Yeah. So we're all, anyone familiar with stress, I should ask? Anyone here familiar with stress? Yes? Yeah. I think no one's really a stranger to that concept. So this session that we're having today, it's really about, you know, for this little while we're together, if you can just relax and imagine that we're just enjoying the view of a mountain and what that would feel like instead. So just noticing even now in your body, if you're holding any tension, can you just relax into your body? Taking some nice deep breaths as we come into this room. Lovely. And it's always nice to start with some collective intentions as we get together, so that we can have a more meaningful and purposeful time together. And that very first step of that is to be here, which is why I said take those nice deep breaths. And if the mind wanders off at any point in time, which it will, even now, maybe you might have noticed it already wandered off a little bit, just bringing it back. And just breathing and being here, yeah? Keeping an open mind, always a great thing, because we are educators and we all know what a detriment it is to have a closed mind when we're learning something. So keeping an open mind, engaging, because in the virtual world, that's always nice, because we can't read body language so much, right? So please engage. Take charge of your learning. If there's any point in time you think, oh, that's a question I'm not sure about, ask Anna's on the chats. And, you know, of course, because we are trying to be here and taking charge of our learning, if you have any distractions around you, maybe closing up those other windows and those little notifications that can distract us from why we're really here for. And questions at clap time. So you'll know when it's clap time, because you'll see me clapping. So we will take those questions at clap time, and Anna will keep track of them in the chat if needed. Yeah, thanks for that, Anna. So everyone all right with the collective intentions? Maybe give me a thumbs up, show me you're here with me. Fantastic. And if you don't have your video, you can still do the thumbs up on through the Zoom. Yeah? Excellent. So we've got five objectives today to cover. Why mindfulness? What is mindfulness? What am I practicing now in my life? And understanding and principle, the very first principle and understanding of mindfulness, and a couple of mindfulness practices that we can go ahead and practice after this session. Yeah. So let's look at why mindfulness. And it's always nice to, you know, have that bird's eye perspective of what is actually going on in the world in terms of mental health, right? So the numbers are quite staggering, and this is from the WHO website, this one. So 280 million people do tend to, you know, find depression a challenge in their lives. 284 million people have anxiety, and it's about 700,000 people each year decide to end their lives. And what I thought was quite staggering about that particular number was that people from the age of 15 to 24, suicide is the fourth leading cause of death for those people in that age group. And, you know, that kind of gives us a little bit of a wake-up call, because we're all educators. Doesn't matter whether you're the admin or developing or student-facing or customer service. We work in the education institution building these beautiful education machines. And if this is what the younger generation, which are the ones that we are also nurturing, are feeling that this is the... That there is no hope in living or whatever, then perhaps could we in little ways begin to change that? And how can we affect that? And perhaps mindfulness could be a great tool that we can somehow slowly involve in and include into the education system in some way. Could that be something that we're thinking about? And of course, in terms of mental health challenges, we know that with mental health challenges also comes the risk of unhealthy coping mechanisms like alcohol use disorder and drug use disorder. So these are just some, you know, having that nice global perspective. And then let's look at us now individually. How can we benefit from mindfulness, right? So we know it can reduce stress. And what I'm going to share with you is from some of the top 10 researchers that you'll find. And Anna has very helpfully compiled a lot of research, which you can find in the bibliography in the Moodle course later on. So these are just some that I will go through. Reducing stress, enhancing well-being, protect attention and working memory. Now, this is such a big part of mindfulness. And you'll see a star there for a couple of reasons. First, because it is very you know, important, because we have so much distractions going on in our days. I remember the times when, you know, I could sit down for hours and just read a book, or see other students sit down and just read a book for hours. And I'm seeing that less and less and less, where you see a teenager just reading a book for hours. So it is because of all these attentional distractions that can come our way, right? So the second reason why the star is there is because throughout my presentation, I've put little stars around. And every time you see the star, ask yourself, has my mind wandered off? And that's that star. So a little check-in to take a deep breath and come back to now. Okay, so just a little check-in there. We know that it can improve empathy, physiological markers of health, like improving sleep and lowering blood pressure. And it's now even used in terms of therapy for relapse of depression, slow down aging. That's I don't know about you, but I'm up for that one. You know? So in terms of slowing down brain atrophy, that's a great tool as well. And it's also used for therapies for quitting smoking and handling food cravings with mindful eating, right? And in terms of student well-being, we've got things like readiness to learn, helping them with their academic performance. And again, attention and concentration is such a big piece. And it's so nice to know, and Anna was the one who shared this with me, about how a couple of her colleagues are even realizing that, you know, and have written a paper now that is on the way to being published about attentional literacy, and how that is something that we can actually teach, because it is true, mindfulness is a learned skill, and that can how that can help with digital disarray. So that's, I'm really looking forward to having that as my weekend reading. Actually, yeah, I've read a little bit and I'm going to keep reading that. And there's so many other things as well. I won't go through all of them because, you know, there is a lot. But some things to note will be things like impulse control, also very much, you know, something that as adults, I think we can all also relate to and use, right? And there was another study with developers and how at the end of their session, their mindfulness training, there was increased feelings of well-being and even an increase in self-perception. So it's almost like there was a bit of confidence that came back for them. So really, it's a very powerful tool. So this is my little hypothesis. And it's that when we are building mindful educators and all of us start becoming more and more mindful and including that into our daily lives, what happens is we create this so much more headspace, and there's so much more that we can now take in, where before we may have felt stressed or trying to cope. Now we're free in our headspace, and that's how we build mindful institutions, which then build and breed those mindful learners who are the ones who are going out into the society. And because they are mindful, their head is clear, they can think very much clearly on what is needed for the planet and building those sustainable solutions for the planet. And you'll hear, I guess, in all of Martin's keynotes, he's always talking about these sustainable solutions. And it all starts from individuals who are caring about the planet. And it's not easy to care about the planet when sometimes we have so many things happening in our own lives that we're trying to manage. But when we get more mindful, then we have that headspace to create these things. Yeah. So it's my little hypothesis, if you will. So we looked at the globe, we looked at individuals, and then we went back up again. So let's come back to us again and ask yourself, why am I here? Why do I reckon mindfulness could be something that I could benefit from in my life? And I'd love to hear from you. So please put that in the chat. And if it's comfortable to share, if it's something that you can share. Thanks. I just read. Oh, wow. So in Scotland, apparently, suicide is actually one of the number one cause of death for men under 45. I just love that. Thank you for sharing that. So, yeah, there are obviously, as a globe, lots of things that we can do to improve individual mental health. Yeah.
While we're waiting for your inputs in the chat, please, I would like to share my experience and why I'm here. I had the pleasure to get introduced into mindfulness in a very difficult period of my life and a very stressful period of my life. And it worked. I mean, it was like a miracle to me. Blessed to the professor that did that effort, Dr. Aga, and helped us so much to not just complete our studies, but live our lives better. So it's an ongoing process. That's why I'm here, and that's why I'll be here the next time you'll give a session, and I will keep trying to push and stay in touch with this idea. And we have inputs from Mary as well. She says that I like the idea of delaying aging and brain atrophy. This is really cool. And Astaria says, calm mind, less stress. And of course, she agrees with Mary. I think we all do. These are really big bonus.
Yeah. To have the mind still active when we're older. I mean, that's wow. Love that, right? And I actually like the idea of growing older, because then I'm learning more and more and more. It means my brain is developing. And, you know, if we look back 10 years ago, how different I am now. And I can't wait, or I'm looking forward rather, I should say, of reaching 10 years later. I just want the brain to be healthy while we're there. Yep. Excellent, thank you. So let's do a quick little poll. And I'm gonna ask for you to guess, how many percent of the time do you think your mind wanders? I've launched the poll there. I hope you can see that.
Yes, we can see it.
Great.
While you give the answer, I'll read Denise's input in the chat. She says that I'm a yoga teacher and practice meditation every day at home and in my classes. I found people, particularly since lockdown, are losing focus on how to live peacefully. How important. It seems no amount of guidance keeps them on track. In my experience, this is particularly prevalent among women aged 35 to 55. They head under the covers with their phones and get deeper and deeper into a state of unhappiness. I want to learn more about how to help these old people to find that inner peace of loss. Oh, this is so,
yeah,
so big. You really speak to my heart, Denise.
Yeah, that's a, such a good question. And you're right. This is such a trying time. And I'll digress a little bit here to talk about what's happening now since it's come up. And you know, COVID has been one of the most, it's been the toughest times for so many of us, right? And when we really think into the human psyche and how we work, we're all wired for survival. And COVID hit everybody's sense of survival all at the same time. And how, if we, with mindfulness, we're often sort of thinking, oh, I'm present, I'm in this moment. We know that the moment that life is finite, but it's not something that we're always consciously aware of. But suddenly COVID put our mortality in front of our faces all the time. And it was a threat to our survival. And then everyone else, even the people that we love dearly, became a threat to our own survival. So if we look at that in that fundamental granular sense of what has happened to the human psyche, we'll realize that no wonder people are reacting the way they're reacting, and they're going inwards, or they're going into fear mode or whatever it may be. And it's so hard for a lot of people to cope. So those of us who have had the opportunity of practicing things like mindfulness or meditation or healthy coping mechanisms, we really should count ourselves very, very, very lucky. And yes, you're right. This is also a time to sort of share certain things that we know, but without discrediting their journey. Because what they've gone through on that psychic level it's not even conscious, right? It's so unconscious what they're going through. And to even express that is so hard when we think about it, right? So compassion is the key, to just keep believing in them, trusting in them, showing them and showering them with the compassion, and just believing that believing in them, you know? So thank you for that great question, Denise. I know I digress quite a bit there, but it's something I am passionate about, letting people understand what is the gravity of the situation that the human race is going through at the moment. Yeah, so I'll end the poll here, and I think you'll be able to see the results. So we have most people guessed 67%. That's 50% who guessed 67%. Nobody guessed 47. Some guessed 87 and 97. So the good news is, I'll share the results. I think we can see the results now. Yeah. So the good news is it's not as bad as we think. It's not 87% or 97%. It's actually 47%. And yeah, there were two Harvard psychologists that actually did that. And they tracked people using their iPhone app, and they found an app that they made, and they found that our mind wanders about 47% of the time. So it's not all bad news. However, it's good to realize that 47% is still about half our lives where we're not really where we are, right? So it's just something to be aware of. But what I thought was really, really interesting from their study is that they found mind wandering is directly correlated to unhappiness. So imagine you're in a neutral mood, or even in a happy mood, and thinks you're happy, blah, blah, blah. And then suddenly your mind wanders. And that mind wandering is what is causing this unhappiness. So that was really quite interesting. So the more present we are, the less unhappy we're going to be. And that's what, you know, mindfulness has been trying to say for a long time. So this was a great study that did that. Another quick little poll. guess how many percent, so we have about, there's been a lot of literature around how many thoughts we have per day, because there's been a lot of, debate around what is a thought, when does a thought end, when does a thought begin. And the most recent one was something from last year where the scientist found that he could track a thought worm, as he calls it, and it's about just over 6,000 thoughts that we have per day. At one point, people thought it was 60,000 or 80,000 because they said, oh, we have to include dreams as well because we're thinking. It's around, 6,000, the latest one. And guess how many percent of that is negative? And how many percent of that is repetitive? So I'm going to put that onto the poll and I'm going to launch that and let's see what you can guess. Lovely. All right, everyone's answered. Yeah. Oh, no, not yet. Fantastic. All right. So I'll end the poll. Everyone's answered now and share the results. Okay. Most people thought it was 30%. Some people said 50. Some people said 60. No one guessed 80. Let's see. And you thought 56% of our thoughts are repetitive. Most people thought 56% of our thoughts are repetitive, right? So let's stop sharing then. I'll share the answer. It's 80%. Our brains, for some reason, and this is called negativity bias or negativity dominance, and it's something that's been talked about quite a lot. And even a lot of people who do think that I am positive, they are positive, but a lot of times the negativity comes in first. They're just able to flip and reframe a lot quicker instead of getting lost in that bubble of negativity. So about 80% of our thoughts tend to be negative. And about 95% of those tend to be repetitive. So we sing the same songs over and over and over and over. And when we think about what we worry about, a lot of times it's the same things. If you think about, oh, what am I going to cook? What am I going to eat? How am I going to finish this work? Can I finish everything in time? If we have kids, are the kids going to be okay? All this sort of stuff, that's the same thoughts over and over and over. Okay, so it's good to understand what could be the thoughts that I'm constantly thinking about and just get mindful of that and realize, oh, I actually don't have to hang on to that. That's something I've already thought about today. Okay, so let's continue. There was another researcher, and he found that 85% of our worries actually never happen. And out of that 15 that did happen, about 79% of people said that, you know what, it's not as bad as I thought. Has anybody had that experience before? Yeah, I think we can all relate to that one, right? And out of the rest that said, oh, it was as bad as I thought, they also agreed that actually we, out of that 79%, they said it's not as bad as they thought. And also they said it's actually a lesson that I really needed to learn. Which meant that 97% of our worries are based on this pessimism that's got no base to it, that's actually unfounded. And that's, so the next time you're worrying, ask yourself, is this really true? Maybe it's not, could this fall under that 97%? Probably yes. And I love this quote from a lovely author. We suffer more from the thoughts about our event than the events themselves. How true is that? We build ourselves up. Something happens and we go, oh, So the suffering is always from the thoughts about the event rather than the actual event. Yeah. Good. So that's clap time. And that's why mindfulness. We've finished that part of why mindfulness. Is there any questions or comments?
We do have a comment from Mary, famous Mark Twain. She says, quote, I have suffered many tragedies in my life, a couple of which actually happened.
That's right. I love that one, actually. Yeah, many tragedies in life and only a few of them.
A couple of them, just a couple of them.
Nice one. Thanks for sharing that, Mary. Now let's go to what is mindfulness. Noticing that there is a star there, so feel free to check in anytime you see that star. So this is probably one of the most famous definitions of mindfulness from John Kabat-Zinn, who is the creator of MBSR, mindfulness-based stress reduction. And you'll see this probably if you Google, this is the definition that comes up the most. So he defines mindfulness as means paying attention in a very particular way, on purpose, in the present moment, and non-judgmentally, right? So he tells us what not to do, which is not to judge, because that's what we're doing, going good, bad, right, wrong, black, white, you know? And there's always these things that we're, and that's fine. That's what our mind was made to do. We were built to have an analytical mind, and that's okay. But we can actually take that step back and realize we don't always have to judge. So I particularly like this definition, which is from Dinah Winston from UCLA. I'm really sorry about the noise. I'm not sure why that's happening. I hope that helped a little bit. So this is from Dinah Winston from UCLA, and she says, paying attention to present moment experience with open curiosity and a willingness to be with what is. So we're not judging. Instead, we're curious, and willingness is the sense of acceptance to be with whatever is presenting itself, right? So the word mindfulness also comes from an ancient Pali language that was spoken in Sri Lanka a long time ago, and that word is sati. And this word sati, you know, when you kind of translate it, it's actually remembering to pay attention, remembering to come back to your current experience, remembering and maintaining this awareness of reality. So if I were to ask you now, what do you maintain? What would you answer in life normally? What is it that you maintain in life? Put it onto the chat. What are some of the things that you maintain, if I may ask that question? Or anyone would like to answer that out loud?
I think mostly maintain negative thoughts, I would say, and the opposite thing.
A lot of times the things that we maintain in our life, if you think about it, we maintain our car. Yeah, always focusing on the future. Yeah, we're planning, that's true. But in life, when we talk about maintenance, the word maintenance, what does maintenance usually mean? We maintain things like our car. Anything else?
House, the daily things that we do again and again and again, mostly.
Yeah.
A routine, yeah. Something.
That's right. We have to maintain our house. If I have a car, our body, we have to maintain, you know, we have to eat, we have to drink water, we have to maintain all these things. So when we look at the word maintaining or maintenance, there is that sense of effort that is required. Yeah. And this is a very important piece in mindfulness, because a lot of times we hear the word just be, just let go, just be. And as much as that is a crucial part of it, it is very much also a cognitive function. It is very much a doing word, because every time the mind wanders, even now while I've been talking, your mind has wandered, you bring it back. You notice everything around you. Can you notice the colors a little bit more? Can you notice the sounds a little bit more? Can you notice how you're feeling a little bit more? And there is so much doing, but we tend to forget that there is doing involved in the being, okay? So although it is a state of being, it's not just a state of being. The being requires some doing. And I always say at all the workshops, if you don't take anything else away, if you take this part of the puzzle back, we're already winning with mindfulness, knowing that it is a verb, so to speak. Yeah? Great. And another word that we like to use a lot in mindfulness is the word cultivate. And let me know in the chat, when do we tend to use this word cultivate the most? When do we like to use the word cultivate?
Farhan says.
Yes, thank you, Farhan. I just realized you've joined us. Welcome. Yes, absolutely. Nice one. It is very much about planting crops and cultivating the seedling. And when we think about planting and cultivating crops, what do we need? We need lots of attention to it. We need lots of nurture. And there's food, there is the right soil, there is sunlight. There's so many little factors that needs to be just right. So we're really nurturing and cultivating something to grow. And if we think of our mind and mindfulness as this beautiful piece of plant or little seed that we're watering each and every day with mindfulness, that's how we cultivate mindfulness. So it's very much a process that we have to maintain, keep going and cultivate with that sense of, I'm not going to trample on this garden. I'm going to walk, tread lightly and nurture it the way it needs to be nurtured. Yeah. And we'll look at how to do that in a little while. So although mindfulness does look like this, you know, and a lot of times people tell me, oh, but Usha, but, you know, I don't want to be one of those people that after practicing so much mindfulness, will I be boring and I'll just talk in this monotone and this is how I'll always speak and it'll be so lovely how I feel, but I will put everybody else to sleep, you know? And it's not necessarily the case at all. In fact, I think the more and more we do practice mindfulness, we are so aware of what we're feeling and thinking that we can really step into our own and have a personality that is truly me, you know, and truly more authentic in that way, because you're not clouded by the worries or the stress, right? So although this is what we tend to see when we're practicing mindfulness, it really is this. It's mental gym. It's not as, I guess, it's not as sexy to market that as opposed to this. So we don't really see that, but it is in fact mental gym. Yeah, great. So I always recommend writing your own working definition of mindfulness, and I'll just share with you mine. And being an educator, I suppose I like to know the why, what, how, when, you know, those questions. So this is my working of definition of mindfulness that I'll share with you. I look at it as a lifelong practice, because practice means it's, you know, something that you keep doing each and every day. Lifelong practice of sustaining present moment awareness to embody at any time. So what is it? Practice of sustaining present moment awareness. When do I do that? It's something that I can embody at any time, right? And how do I do it? With intention and compassion. And we'll look at compassion a little bit more. But intention is pretty much going, you know what, today I'm going to be mindful. Oh yeah, my mind wandered. I'm going to be mindful for the next 1 minute, you know? Or whatever it is, but always having that little pieces of intention. And why? For my own inner peace. That's why I'm doing it. Yeah. So in the course, in your webinar, in your course, there's actually a place where you can share your own working definition of mindfulness. Is there anyone who would like to share something that's popping up in their head now? Sorry.
I don't see something in the chat.
Okay. I was kind of buying time because I really needed a drink. For some reason, there was a tickle in my throat.
Okay. I'll just jump in to say that in course activities, inside the course, you'll find several activities which I will explain as we go. We hope that you will go through them after the session. All the activities will be released, so you may move on, Usha.
Thank you, Anna. And that's how you go. Oh, clap time. Any questions about what is mindfulness? That's sort of one of the easiest ways that I could explain it. And it is a very experiential thing, so the more you experience it, that's when you understand it more and more, I suppose. Yeah. Anything from the chat? No?
Otherwise, I'll move on. Everything is clear here. Don't see anything in the chat. You can move on.
Thank you. So the next one, what am I practicing? So there is another video that I've got on the Moodle course by Shauna Shapiro, also a researcher in mindfulness. And she tells the story of how she got into it and how a monk told her, what we practice grows stronger. And it's such an important thing to remember, because a lot of times we're practicing things unconsciously. You know, these little habits that we have, we do them because that's what we've always done. And there are some that we are conscious are not best for our health or our mental health. But some could be that we don't normally have time to take stock of. For example, things like judgment, things like impatience, things like self-doubt or worries or stress or anxiety, maybe even withdrawal, right? Frustration. And I hear this so much in just the language of people. There was a coaching client of mine who said, you know, he just dropped his keys and he was so upset with himself for dropping his keys. And he's like, ah, and then he's bending to pick up his keys. And all he did was drop his keys. Why are we operating on this constant undertone of frustration, or that undertone of, I have to do everything right? There's this sense of stress that we put on ourselves that we might not actually even realize. So it's a good time while we're all here together to go, oh, is this something? Changing habits is the most difficult thing. Absolutely, Nicole. So, so right. There's a great book by James Clear called Atomic Habits, actually, which is it's a good one to read for changing habits. Yeah, you know of that book. Yeah, great book. And so it's a good time to sort of ask, while we're all here reflecting, is there something here that I could potentially be practicing, you know? And maybe instead of practicing some of these things, we could be practicing these things instead, the ones in the yellow text. And if we look, the thing with mindfulness is we're never labeling things as bad or good, right? And we're just taking things as they are and giving them the attention that they deserve. So if we give judgment the attention that it deserves, then we can look at it as, oh, that's judgment presenting itself. Ah, and that's the thing that's reminding me to be open. Ah, impatience is presenting itself. And that's exactly the emotion I need to remind me to be patient. And if we look at all of that, just like reminders on our phone or reminders on our to-do list, then none of those emotions need to be good or bad. And there's this constant resistance that we sometimes feel when we get stressed, and we're resisting with our body, we're resisting anxiety with our body, we're resisting all of that. And that resistance is creating more and more of the thing, because that's what we're practicing, you know? So if we just treat them as not good, not bad, if they're just there for a reason and understand the reason behind them, then we're able to flip and flip and flip more and more easily. Yeah. So what we practice grows stronger. And is there something from that list that you think you can practice more? Feel free to put in the chat. Oops. Patience. Thank you, Mary. Yes, me too. A lot of times patience to finish the work. Sometimes I want to see results really quickly, and then I go, oh, you know, actually, I'm holding on too strongly. I need to be patient. I can let go. Thanks, Mary. Anyone else?
I was thinking about anxious. Yeah.
Yeah.
Judgmental. Yeah. Then he says all of them. I think we have a lot of work to do with ourselves.
Oh, all of us. It's a constant journey, isn't it?
Yeah.
Everyone, yeah. For me, every day. And anxiety, if we think about anxiety, and we ask, where does anxiety live? Anxiety lives in the future.
Yeah.
If we think about something that's already passed and we know that that's gone, chances are we don't feel anxious about it. We can feel surprised that happened, or disgusted that it happened, or horrified that it happened, but we don't feel that same level of, oh no, that uncertainty, that's gone, because we already know what's going to happen, right? So anxiety is pretty much an emotion that lives in the future. So anxiety is just a reminder to come back to now. Yeah, so it's a beautiful emotion to have to come back to now. Yeah, so it's a good one that I'm also always practicing. So So first, I just saw Nicole. Yes, all of them, absolutely. That's why I put all of them there, because that's probably the most general one. accepting the unknown future makes us anxious. Absolutely, Mary. It's something that I talk about a lot, uncertainty in some of the workshops that I run. And there's so many techniques actually out there in dealing with uncertainty. Maybe we could do that another time. So moving on to the first principle and understanding of mindfulness, right? So understanding one is your mind wanders. Did anybody's mind not wander this whole 40 minutes that we've been together? Nobody, right? Did anybody's mind did wander the whole 40 minutes that we've been together? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So our mind wanders. So the very first principle of mindfulness is that we accept your mind. We accept that the nature of our mind is to wander. It's this beautiful free child that's out and wanting to explore the world. And if we look at our mind that way, it just becomes so much more easier to accept that the nature of our mind is to wander. Just like the nature of a rabbit is to hop, the nature of a flower is to bloom. It's just nature. We can accept all those other things. The nature of a dog is to bark. We can accept that, but we tend to not accept that our mind is also something that likes to wander. So accept your mind. Yeah. And just because we accept our mind does not mean that we identify with our mind. So what do I mean by this? We accept that the nature of the mind is to wander. Okay. So we wander, we have a sad thought, it wanders, it has another sad thought, wanders, it has another sad thought. But that does not mean my identity is that I'm a sad person. Okay, might have an angry thought a few times a day, does not mean that my identity is an angry person. But a lot of times we mix the two and we go, oh, I'm having all these sad thoughts, I must be a sad person. I'm having all these bad thoughts, I must be a bad person. You know, and we fix this thoughts with identity together, and we don't know how to break free from that, right? And it's really about letting go and understanding that a thought is just a thought. So even sometimes, like the other day, I was driving and I saw these kids playing on the road, and my first thing was like, oh no, I hope no one runs across the road. They were fine playing in the garden, but that was my first negativity bias that went straight there. Right? And I thought, oh, why did I have that thought? That's weird. And then I said, hang on, that's not weird. It's just a thought. I don't have to explain myself or try and form an identity of why did I have that thought? What does that mean for me? Who am I? And we go into this overthinking and overwhelming without realizing that. And Eckhart Tolle says this so beautifully, the author of The Power of Now. He goes, we are not our thoughts, nor are we the sum of all our thoughts. Yeah. So we are way, way more than this one transitory behavior, one transitory thought. And it's just so important to remember that people are not their behaviors. We are not our behaviors. We're just a product of what sort of happened from that moment. But at each moment, if we allow and accept, we can form new identities. We don't have to be fixated to an identity. And you hear this phrases of identity all the time. Oh, but I'm not that kind of a person, or I'm this type of person. So be really, really careful and mindful if you do hear yourself saying those words, and ask yourself, have I fixated on an identity here? And is there something that I can be more open to if I was not so fixated on that identity that could perhaps serve my life a little bit more? Okay, so every time the thought comes, we can just go, it's just a thought. It's just a thought. Yeah, great. So how do we accept your mind? The piece to that is having compassion to ourselves. And in the bibliography, you'll find a researcher, Kirsten Neff, who's done a lot of studies on compassion. So feel free to explore all those links there in your leisure. And how do we explore this compassion to ourselves? Is very simply speaking to our mind like we would to a five-year-old, being a loving adult to a five-year-old. How would a loving aunt or a loving parent, or just, you know, somebody who cares about a young child, how would you speak to that young child? Okay. Because it's wandering off. They're wandering off in the playground and go, darling, come back. Darling, come back. So these are the three words I always like to say. Darling, come back. Every time the mind wanders, we go, oh, darling, come back. Darling, come back. And the most important part of those three words is the word darling, because that's the compassion that we're showing ourselves. Okay, so darling, come back. So practice it for the next few times your mind wanders while we're here together. And I see Denise has got a comment. Is that the we are not our thoughts concept? Yes, absolutely, Denise. Yeah, we are not our thoughts. We're way, way more than our thoughts. We are, you know, we've got some, we've got hopes, we've got dreams, we are, we've got, you know, experiences, we've got so much within us that is, and a thought cannot encapsulate that, right? So we are not our thoughts, absolutely not. We're way, way more than that. So there are nine attitudes of mindfulness that John Kabat-Zinn does cover. And the first two is non-judging, and there's also curiosity is one of them. So we looked at non-judging, not judging things as black and white or right or wrong, and understanding that we can operate from this sense of willingness and openness and curiosity, and that always remembering to be that child in that playground, you know. And these two are actually written in, there is some reading that you can do about that in the course as well. So I'll leave you to read that in your own time. And there's an in-course activity, my favorite one, is to put a picture, if you can, of your five-year-old self in the forum. And, you know, I've already put a picture of myself and my twin sister there from when we were around that age. And it's just to share with each other this sense of, yes, I can be compassionate with myself. And I am going to talk to myself like I would a loving adult would to a five-year-old, right? And if you can't find a picture of a five-year-old self, or if you're not comfortable sharing, that's completely fine. Find a picture that makes you feel like a five-year-old again and share that picture there. Okay, great. So now let's just take a little bit of time. Mary is saying, I was looking for a photo this morning. Fantastic. You're onto it. So examine your language even right now. Can you think of potentially three unhelpful phrases that you may be saying to yourselves, especially those phrases that are masked as they're okay, like dropping our keys and going, ah. Or saying things like, oh, that was silly of me. Why did I do that? That was stupid of me. And we hear these phrases all the time. But these are non-compassionate language. Sometimes we use even more uncompassionate language, like, oh, that was, I can't believe I did that. Why did I do that? That was so, so, horrible of me to do that. Or, you know, so it doesn't matter what degree it is. And if it's comfortable enough, I suggest be brave, put it out there, put it in the chat. Because I know I do that too, right? Fantastic. Thank you, Mary.
I'm often thinking, what kind of mother am I? It's very common thought. Yeah. Oh, no, my coat is full of bags, from Farhan. And Nicole says, others are always better than me. This is a good one, Nicole. I can say that.
Yeah. And this, the comparisons, in mindfulness, we talk about comparisons quite a bit, and comparisons, we call that, that's when the ego mind is talking. Actually, it's not the authentic self. And this ego mind always wants to compare myself with others, myself with my future plans of who I should be or where I was before, and now I'm not doing as good as before, and all that sort of comparisons. And these are really good awareness that we all have. So thank you so much for sharing.
Denise and Jessica are agreeing on that. I'm sorry. It's like that, the unhelpful phrase. And Mary's about, I'm never going to manage this. I doubt.
Yeah, so true. And these are unhelpful phrases. So if we can flip them around and go, oh, it's just a thought, and that's it. We leave it at that, you know, and we can then pick what else I'm going to say next, you know. So if I think, oh, I'm never going to manage this. And I felt that way this week. I'll be very, very honest. There was so much to do. And this week at one point I was like, oh gosh, this is a lot. And I think the last couple of days I slept for like 6 hours and I went, oh wow, I'm really tired. And then I went, ah, I don't know if I can do all this. And then I went, hang on, that's a very good, that's just a thought. And that's a good reminder to come back to trust. I'm going to trust that my best is good enough because that's all I can do. I'm just going to do my best and leave the rest, right? So, yeah, it's lovely that we can have these thoughts because then we go, oh, it's just a thought. And what am I going to think now that I've got this moment, this new moment that's presented itself with a new thought that I can have, right? And we're more intentional about those things, yeah? So thank you all for sharing that. I love your joke there, Farhan. It's a good one. Clap time. Any questions now about the first principle of mindfulness, which is to accept that your nature of the mind is to wonder? All good? Go ahead.
I don't see something in the chat.
Great. So we're running just perfect in terms of time, I think. So great. We're looking at mindful practices. We'll just look at a couple. So this one is called using semantics to go into observer mode. And I do talk about observer mode a lot more in some of my other courses. But just a quick thing is that you are looking at yourself having the experience, so to speak. So we can use language to help us with that. So even now, think of some upsetting thought that you normally have. Maybe on a scale of 0 to 10, it's a 6. We won't start with the highest one. Just something that's a 6 or 7. Maybe I am bad at my job, or I am, whatever it may be. You know, something that's an upsetting thought to you. I am impatient, perhaps. Okay. And now, completely believe it for 10 seconds. Just feel into that and go, oh, I am impatient. I am impatient. I'm impatient. Just 10 seconds. Believe whatever it is that you believe in and feel that in your body. And now say the words, oh, I'm having the thought that I am whatever it is. I'm having the thought that I am impatient. I'm having the thought that I am whatever it may be. Okay? And just notice in your body what that feels like. And then now say to yourself, I notice that I am having the thought that I am. I notice that I am having the thought that I am whatever. I notice that I am having the thought that I am. And notice what happens again. Okay. Did anybody feel a difference in how their body felt when we were using language to distance yourself? Anyone?
Just
you like felt a bit of a
feel the distance.
Yeah. So language is so interesting and important part of our lives. Yeah, lighter. It felt lighter. Nice. Thanks, Jessica. Thanks, Asteria. Yeah, more light. So we can actually use semantics to help us create the sense of I'm going into observer mode. I'm just going to observe that thought. Oh, okay. And then we notice it. Fantastic. Yeah.
Denise says that. That heavy feeling I get in my pelvis when stretching lifts.
Wow, nice. Thank you. Yeah, it's like suddenly the weight is a little bit less. Yeah, and especially when we're sitting down, all that weight is on our hips and we're like, yeah, and suddenly we can feel lighter. Great. So the next one is a very simple breathing technique. It's called the labeling technique, and we use 3 words here: rising, falling, and drifting. So every time you breathe in, you fill your belly, you fill your lungs, and you allow your belly to expand. And in your mind, you see the word rising. And as you allow your belly to contract, expel the air, you say falling. And then if the mind wanders in between, we go drifting, drifting, and then come back to rising and falling. And what this does, it stops us from saying, oh, my mind went off again, right? So the way we say drifting is very important. We don't go drifting, oh, drifting, oh, drifting. We don't do that. We go drifting, drifting, come back to rising, falling, okay? So let's just, I'm going to play a little bit of music. Let's just do that for a couple of minutes. So we get a feel for it. And I hope you can, how is that music for everyone? Can you hear the music okay? And my voice over the music? Is that all right? Anna, that's good, yeah? Thank you. So just closing down your eyes, just for a couple of minutes, and just allow your whole body to relax. This is your time and your space to just be. And just acknowledge this beautiful breath of life that is life creating, life sustaining, and life giving. And with every deep breath that you inhale, just repeat the word rising. Every deep breath in, filling the lungs, rising. And every time you exhale, just repeat the word falling. And just keep this going as you just breathe deep belly breaths. And just allowing your whole body to relax even more. Knowing that if the mind wanders, that's okay. We just go drifting, drifting, and coming back to rising and falling. Coming back to rising and falling. And if we need to, we go into drifting, drifting, and coming back to your breath. As you relax your head, your eyes, your jaw, your throat, relaxing your shoulders, your fingertips, all the way down your body, feeling all your organs just rising and falling. All the way down your legs to all 10 toes, rising and falling, rising and falling. And as you begin to relax even more, know that whenever you need some time to just feel some peace, all you have to do is come back to your breath. And it can guide you to your peace and your calm. Taking three rounds of deep breath now. Three deep breaths, the deepest breath you've taken all day long. And whenever you are ready, just gently opening your eyes. Thank you. So that was just a simple one. And I've got a recording of it. We've got a link to it of a breathing that's about 6 minutes breathing. It doesn't say the words rising, falling, but now that you know these three words, while you're listening to that breathing practice, you can go rising, falling, drifting, drifting, rising, falling. And that's all in the course. And we do require you to put in some bits of reflections, and there are three reflections to log for both the semantics practice as well as the breathing practice. And every time you log one in, the next log opens up. Yeah, so do that, and you know, you can get the mindfulness badge. So instead of me summarizing everything, I'd love to hear what your top three takeaways maybe from a couple of people. Would anybody like to share what their top three takeaways were? You can put it in the chat, or you can share. Actually, maybe everyone can unmute themselves even and just share.
Well, people is writing, you can start. I think that the last activity is I've been quite stressed late week, and I was trying to remember those guided mindfulness meditations. And yes, I think this rising, fall, drifting, it's the best idea, quick and very effective to get you organized. That's one though. And Nicole says, accepting and breathing and darling, come back. Yes, I get that too.
Yeah, darling, come back. That's something that I always have to remind myself as well. Forget, it's easy to forget, but yeah. That's why I'm running these sessions, because then I get to remember all those techniques as well. Yeah,
Mary, I learned about that. I learned about mindfulness delaying aging. I didn't know what was one of its benefits. I also like the darling comeback idea. Anastasia says, understanding the importance of staying mindful, accepting the mind, practicing makes stronger.
Absolutely, yeah. So what are we practicing? So let's practice mindfulness together, all of us. Thank you. So I already spoke about some of the post-webinar activities. Go through them. And yeah, there's a few more, I think, in there. And if you have any questions or anything like that, I'm always available. And I really want to give a special shout out to Anna and Jessica here, because they've been so amazing to work with, so easy to work with. And you know, I really, really appreciate all that you guys do, especially for the Moodle community as well. Yeah, and I think you've got a few things to say, Anna. And I do have a little bit of... announcements later at the end, but I do want to say that if anyone is interested in things like group coaching or corporate training for your team, or a monthly newsletter that I send out with latest articles and things like that, feel free to email me, and we can always take this chat offline. Anna, you've got, I'll show this again later, but I think Anna, you've got some things to say.
Well, yes, first of all, thank you so much, Usha, for having you here today. It was a brilliant session to start the weekend. It's a Saturday morning in Greece, so it was a gift to be here. And before you all go, I would like to tell you a few tips how to get involved in a Moodle Academy, because you can help us grow and contribute to its development, as Usha did today. You can suggest topics or contribute to webinars. Come here, you will find in our site the suggest ideas, and you can also tell us how you can contribute to those courses. Please do share your expertise, and yeah, why not contribute and get a badge about that. And in the next last slide from me, I would like to invite you to spread the word about the Moodle Academy. Tell your friends, tell your colleagues. Join Moodle Academy, create an account, take the open courses we offer. The course that Usha prepared, and as well as the session, will be always open and available to you under open licenses, so you can use them. And you can run them in your own context. So there are a lot of things to gain here. You can share and spread the word literally, and invite more people in the academy. And if you are an educator and you have experience in teaching with Moodle, come on and take the Are You Ready for the MEC quiz, and check if you are ready for the Moodle Educator Certificate, an international certificate from Moodle HQ. And I'm going to stop the recording now. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Sam.